My name is Paco Magsaysay. I'm with Carmen's Best Dairy Products. We're here today in our farm, Rio Fresh Dairy in Bay, Laguna.
Hi everyone, I'm Jake Borja. I'm the Operations Supervisor for Rio Fresh Dairy Farms Incorporated. Welcome to our farm.
So today, we're going to show you our farm operations and our processing plant for the milk. And you'll get a better understanding of the term farm to table. The farm was set up in 2007, 2008. And it was actually meant to supply fresh milk to the market, to the local market. And in 2009, we incorporated Carmen's Best Dairy Products and started selling ice cream in 2011. So we'll show you the connection between our dairy farm and Carmen's Best ice cream. What we have here are corn stalks, which is used as a feed for the cows. So we have contract farmers that supply us what you see here. And our cows eat 10% of their body weight. So if the average cow weighs anywhere from 300 to 400 kilos each, we have to feed them 30 to 40 kilos a day. So what you see here is part of what we feed them, because we actually feed them a mix of other products like spent grain, soya pulp, and malt, which is a byproduct of Milo and Ovaltine. But if you look over here, we have a chopper, and this chopper will cut the leaves or the grass so that it'll be smaller and be easier for the cow to digest. And it comes out like this. Also, it really depends on the cow's stage in their life, whether they're calves, whether they're dry, or they're milking, or they're pregnant. Parang tao, we have different feed cycles, no? Like when we're babies, you feed them formula, or when they're a little bit bigger, you feed them Cerelac. As they get older, different diet. So if you notice, the corn stalks that we buy includes the ears. So this is what the cows eat along with the corn stalks. Para masarap yung pagkain nila. This is the byproduct of malt, or from Ovaltine and Milo. And over here, the white one is the soya pulp. So it's soya pulp that we mix with the feed mix. And this is also part of the soya pulp.
We're here right now in our calf barn. So we have here our animals ages 0 to 6 months of age. So we keep them in this barn to, in a way, protect them from the harsh environment, like extreme heat and rain, and because they're very susceptible to, you know, heat stress. So we keep them here for them to, you know, avoid having you know, illness like respiratory diseases. So as you can see, we have different animals colors, no? As you can see, we have the brown, the black and white, and the black. So because we have different animal breeds here, so the primary animal breed that we have here is the Holstein Friesian Sahiwal cross. And eventually, we introduce Jersey in our herd. So that's the brown one. And the black and white is the Holstein Friesian hair coat. And the black is the Sahiwal. So during this stage, especially the younger ones, so we feed them still with milk. No? When they get older, about 2 months, so we can already feed them with grass and the industrial byproducts that we're getting from outside. These are the animals less than 2 months of age. So as you can see, they are housed in individual calf pen. These are the animals that still feeds on milk. This is less than a month old. No? So they're like, you know, dogs. No? Because they don't have hands. No? So this is, the tongue is the organ of prehension. No? So it acts like their hands. No?
So the milk that we give them here is called the colostrum, or the milk from the mother. And kumbaga, that's the closest thing to breastfeeding the baby is in a dairy farm. But other farms, they sell that milk. They'll sell the milk of the mother because they'll make money from it, selling it as milk. But for us, what's more important is the foundation or the base of the calves. Kasi pag lumaki yan, kailangan maganda yung kanilang body and yung foundation ng kanilang paglaki nila. So we really give them the milk of the mother.
So in a dairy farm, so we don't usually keep male animals. So what we do is that immediately after giving birth, no, siguro at least a week or so, so kailangan ibenta na agad yung animal, no? Kasi hindi naman namin siya palalakihin para gatasan kasi wala namang ano.
The animals you see in a dairy farm are supposed to be 99% female because sila ang naggagatas, yun ang binibenta namin, yung milk, or pinaprocess namin to other dairy products. Ang term cow is for female, no? Ang sa lalaki, it's called bull or bull calf, no? So wala kang makikitang cow na lalaki kasi cow is for female. Unlike, let's say, you say elephant, elephant can be both male or female, or tiger can be male or female. But cow is specific to female animal, and bull calf is for the male counterpart.
So the technical term would be dairy cattle, if you want to describe both the male and the
both
female.
Male, yeah.
So dairy cattle.
So if you see all of them here, they're relaxing, they're resting, and as a dairy farmer, that's a good sign because relax sila, nagpapahinga sila, nagpuproduce sila ng gatas. Kasi we really take a lot of time and effort to give them as what we call cow comfort. No? So importante na meron silang fan para bumaba ng konti yung temperature, shade for them, tapos magandang ventilation dito. Meron rin kaming back scratcher dyan para pag nangangati yung gilid-gilid nila, they can go to it and have their back scratched. So, yun ang talagang binibigyan namin ng malaking importansya is their cow comfort. I don't want to speak so loud kasi baka ma-startle sila o magising sila. So ayan, nagpapahinga sila. Ayan. We milk the cows twice a day at 5 a.m. and 5 p.m. And you have to milk them every day. Maski na holiday, maski na Sunday, maski na bagyo, tag-ulan. You have to milk them every day. Kasi yung milk na pinuproduce nila, sumasakit yung kanilang udders. So by milking them, it releases the pressure and it makes them more comfortable. Like I mentioned earlier, we always want our cows to be comfortable. And this is where the cows get milk. And as I mentioned earlier, they get milk twice a day. 5 a.m. and 5 p.m. So I will be the cow and Jake will explain to you what I'm doing as a cow.
So this is the milking chute. And while waiting, no, we put feed, no, dito. So the cow will go inside.
Kaharap yung cow dito.
Kaharap dito.
Kaharap dito yung baka.
Oo.
Tapos habang kumakain yung baka, Kasi hindi kami nag-hand milk ng baka. We use pumps to milk the cows.
And this collects the milk from the quarters, no?
So all cows have four quadrants and they are individual quadrants. Pag magkasakit ang isang quadrant, and of course, syempre ayaw namin magkasakit ang isang quadrant, we do everything to treat it. But kung sakali na magka-infection or hindi na siya gumagana, ang output na lang ng baka mo is three quadrants, which is only 75% of their normal milk production. So pag nasa dalawang quadrant ang naapekto, 50% na lang ho yung pwedeng ibigay ng gatas ng baka sa inyo. So, hindi yung apat na quadrant is four individual quadrants. Hindi siya isang malaki na apat ang labasan. So, apat na individual quadrants ho siya.
I just would like to add yung the importance of milk hygiene. So, with milk hygiene kasi, so that's how you help then the cow, no, to protect yung mga dede niya. So we use disinfectants after milking so that walang papasok na mikrobyo after milk production. And also the practice of feeding them right after milking helps them na nakatayo lang sila, and then they won't sit or lie down dun sa flooring na madumi. So isa yun sa mga tawag dito, yung mga management practices na ginagawa natin to avoid mastitis. And also I just would like to add na dito sa farm, no, we play classical music, no, to make the cows relax, and at the same time to mask the external noise coming from sa mga equipment natin. And sometimes you cannot avoid having, you know, noisy employees going around na ano, so hindi, para at least hindi nila naririnig yung ibang tunog. Their focus mainly dun lang sa pagkagatas. So, ang epekto rin kasi ng classical music is that yung sinasabing Mozart effect, no? So, it can be na, yun nga, mas nare-relax sila to give more milk. Our milkers are mostly female. So, they're the ones handling the milking cows. They're milking, kumbaga, sila yung naghahawak ng mga dede. So, maybe the explanation to that is that as mothers, no, they empathize, no, with the cows because they know the feeling of it, no, kung paano yung mag-breastfeeding and at the same time magbigay ng gatas, no, sa mga anak.
But in other countries, it's male, it's guys who milk the cows.
But in history, no, because the males are the hunters, so the females stays at home, so they're the ones who take care of livestock animals. So they all, that's why we have the milkmaid, eh, di ba? Nakita niyo yung gatas na milkmaid, yung meron siyang ano. So dalagang nagagatas ng baka. So yun yung origin ng ano natin. So babae talaga yun.
But I have to explain, further explain, yung mga countries na gumagamit ng lalaki, it's actually very much industrialized or automatic, no? So meron siyang, if you can imagine, a turntable na napakalaki na kayang sampahan ng mga baka. So when the cows get on the turntable, so you're talking 300 to 500 kilos per cow, ha? Pag sampa ng baka sa isang part ng turntable, yung platform, doon na linalagay yung pump ng lalaki. Pag umikot siya, tapos na yung milking. So, isa-isa pumapasok yan. So, habang may pumapasok, umiikot yung turntable, pagdating sa dulo, lumalabas sila. So, tuloy-tuloy yan. So, two guys can milk anywhere from 3,000 to 5,000 cows. No? Whereas here, it's not automatic.
This is limited. No?
So it's called the herringbone system.
Yeah. So, we can just accommodate 14 to 16 heads at a time, depending on the size of the cow. Yeah. So
iba rin yung sistema sa industrialized countries.
Yes. Depending on how many cows you have in the herd.
Yeah.
So the more cows that you milk, it's more efficient to use yung mga ganong klase.
Malaking turntable.
Type of milking system. So aside from the milking parlor, so we have here in our shed, no, yung aming clean room, and then we have the animal clinic and the feeds room, no. We also have the holding area, the holding pen, no, for activities like, for example, we do monthly vitamin supplementation of our cows and weekly pregnancy diagnosis of our milking cows. So we put the animals inside that chute, so to secure them, to restrain them, and then para mas madaling mag-handle ng animals, because you can just imagine, no, a 500 kilogram animal, no? Kunyari maglalaban siya. So kailangan mo siyang i-restrain talaga by putting them inside the working chute, no.
Actually, Holly's was the first that was put together. It was my dad and his friends who started Holly's Farm. And that was around 2007, 2008. And in fact, when the cows came in through the NDA, the National Dairy Authority, wala pa kaming lupa nun. So itong land na kung saan tayo, na long-term lease namin to from a family here. And we are leasing from them, as yung mga structures na nakikita natin dito, doon kami gumastos. So that's where we put our capital. Instead of purchasing land, we use the capital to build the structures. So here, we're going now to the processing plant. And not all dairy farms have a processing plant, ha? Because a processing plant costs a lot of money. So if you look at our processing plant, this was not initially part of the idea when we put up the dairy farm. It was just a dairy farm. But we were having trouble working with other processors. So we figured that we would put up our own dairy processing facility. So this is it right here.
Because, syempre, energy is, you know, the cost of electricity is getting higher every time. So at least, no, with this, no, we have renewable energy, and it's green energy. In a way, no, we save money by using this, no, for the processing plant. So this can generate at least 100 kilowatt. No?
We transport the milk in milk cans, 50-liter milk cans. So we are in contract with another dairy farm which is nearby. And of course, we check the quality of the milk. As we have milk analyzers. So that way, we're able to maintain the quality of the milk or the consistency of what the quality that we have. So this is our lab. The milk analyzer is the blue machine. So we run the machines every other day. So as I mentioned earlier, we milk the cows every day, and all the other farms that we work with milk their cows every day. So yung araw na hindi kami nagpo-process, dinalagay ho namin sila sa mga vat namin to store them for 24 hours before processing them. On the right side, we have a cream separator. Now, a cream separator works where you run the raw milk in the cream separator, and yung milk solids or the fat is going to one side, and then the non-fat milk or the liquid milk comes out in another side. So pag gumawa kami ng whole milk, we put back 3.7% fat. Pag gumawa kami ng non-fat milk, low-fat milk, we put 2%. Pag non-fat milk, hindi na namin binabalik yung fat kasi non-fat milk siya. That's why our ice cream tastes very different, because we use natural cream or fat from the cow's milk. It's better if you have your own farm if you're gonna put this up, because if you put this up, you'll have to work with other farms. And then you have to think about the logistics. I don't know of a group that has put up a dairy processing that did not own a farm. Okay, so unless you own a farm, that's the only time it's worth putting up your own dairy processing. So, but to put up a dairy processing plant and not own a farm, well, you can try it, but you know, this is very capital intensive, and you run the risk of farmers not wanting to work with you, or you know. So that's why I don't know of a dairy processing plant that is a standalone business, yung wala siyang connected na dairy farm or what. No? So the people who buy dairy processing plants normally have a farm or a cooperative. Like Badaco, Batangas Dairy Cooperative, they have their own processing plant, but they have their cooperative members who will process with them. So kung magtatayo ka ng sarili mong processing plant, you run the risk that nobody's gonna work with you. So here, we have the other part of the dairy processing, which is the pasteurizing and homogenizing of the milk. We use an HTST processing system, which is called high temperature, short time. So we pasteurize the milk at 67.5 degrees for a few seconds, and then we drop it down to cooling temperature immediately. Now, the difference between an HTST inline system and a batch processing is, sa batch processing, iniinit mo yan to reach a certain temperature. Tapos, pag ma-reach mo yung temperature na yon, ipapatay mo yung apoy, pababa yung temperature, naluluto pa rin yung gatas. Kaya iba yung kanyang lasa sa HTST system. Because we have an HTST system, we can also homogenize the milk. Anong ibig sabihin ng homogenize? Ibig sabihin nun, kung makita mo yung gatas namin, hindi mo makikita yung fat na umaangat sa taas ng gatas. Diba? So, when you see milk that has fat on top, that's because the milk is non-homogenized. Or pag ininom mo yun, everything else is like non-fat. Kasi nainom mo na lahat ng fat, umakyat na lahat ng fat. Diba? But when it's homogenized, the taste is equal from the top to the bottom. Pareho yung lasa niya. Because the fat is broken down equally throughout the whole bottle of milk. Okay, so that's the beauty of having a homogenized product. It's more consistent yung taste niya from the first sip to the last sip. We are the only one actually in the Philippines that has an HTST fresh milk processing because other farms use ESL or extended shelf life. Yung processing namin, dahil 72.5 degrees lang kami, our milk lasts for 7 to 10 days. Now you go to ESL, extended shelf life, it's a higher temperature, but it lasts 3 to 4 weeks, no? But because it lasts 3 to 4 weeks, ang pagluto niya, sabi ko mas mataas ang temperature niya, iba na yung lasa. Hindi na kasing sarap ng fresh milk temperature. But ang kapalit nun is a longer shelf life, which is better for people who sell milk. But kami, ang habol namin is having majority of the vitamins still there, the nutrients, and of course the taste, no, of the product. So here we have our semi-automatic filling machine, and that's used to fill our milk. And on the left side, we have a filling machine for the yogurt. So these are the machines that we have to help us pack the end product. This is also where we make the kesong puti. Yung kesong puti namin, hindi siya nagka-crack. Kasi pag ginagawa namin yung kesong puti, hindi namin hiraan ng tubig. Many farmers in the Philippines, because they want to lower their cost, they mix a lot of water. So ano nangyayari? Nagka-crack yung cheese. And that's not proper cheese. Okay, so this is our kesong puti, which we serve on a cracker and a sliced tomato. So grini-grill ho namin yung kesong puti before putting it here. The kesong puti, as I mentioned earlier, is a type of cheese that we make here, and the milk comes all from our cow. So this is a cow's milk. We do not mix any water in it. Kaya kung titingnan ho ninyo, hindi siya nagka-crack. Ito naman ho ang amin fresh milk. So itong gatas na ho to, galing sa baka lahat yan, walang halong tubig. We pasteurize and homogenize it, and we bottle it. And this is the product. Konti, nabawasan lang ho kasi linigay ko sa kape ko. Kaya hindi ganito ang lagyan namin ng gatas. Talagang puno ho siya hanggang leeg ang pagpuno ng milk namin. Linagay ko lang sa kape ko yung gatas. Kaya masarap sa kape yung linalagyan ng fresh milk kasi mas masarap ho siya.